to God today.
What does Christmas really mean? And what are we celebrating? It's a wonderful time, but I wonder if we forget. Thank you.
welcome to our candlelight service today. Let's all make our way to our seats, and you can also grab our hymn books together and stand. Let's sing song 314, 314, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. We'll sing that first verse, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, Glory to the Newborn King, song 314.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. Let angelic hosts proclaim.
Hail the Hamborn Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all he brings, rest with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die, born to raise the
come, desire of nations, come, fix in us thy humble birth. Rise up, woman's concrete seed, bruised in us the serpent's head. Adam's likeness thou efface, stamp thine image in its place.
Good evening. Welcome to church tonight on a Wednesday night, and looking forward to candlelight service. It's a great time. We're kind of changing the overheads just a little bit. I wanted to at least see your smiling face, and I wasn't sure how many people were here, and now I know. And so thank you for being here tonight, and looking forward to the message, a little bit of singing, and just these special services we have through this time of our year. And it's just a great time to get together and just think about all the Lord has done for us through the entire year. We look at this as the start of Christmas, but it's the end of our year, and it's just so easy to reflect on not only this gift that God has given us at Christmas, but all throughout the year. And so just looking forward to talking about that some tonight, and thank you for being here. Thank you for your prayers. I'm alive. I promise I'm okay. I felt so terrible having to do that on Sunday night, since it's one of my favorite services of the year, and I didn't get a chance to sing any fun songs. And so Brother Rick's going to lead those out in the parking lot after church tonight if you want to stay behind and sing some of the fun Christmas. Anyways, I am feeling much, 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 much better. And so thank you so much for your prayers. And I know it really put a bummer at the end of the night. But the cookies were great. I did see the cookies. I took a few bites of those, and that was it. But it wasn't the cookies that made me sick, I promise you that. But I know we've got some others that haven't felt well the last few days. So no more Christmas parties, no more fellowships at everyone's houses, no more super spreader events. Can you help me out with that, please, if you would? But I'm so glad you're here. I'm looking forward to praying together for just a moment. Have some special things to pray about tonight, and then looking together in God's Word as well. But let's pray and ask God to help us with this service. And I know it's a fun service, but God has a message for us tonight as well, okay? So don't let the different atmosphere change our focus on why we're here tonight. Lord, thank you for being so good to us. Thank you for loving us as you do. Thank you for loving our church. And even on Sunday, we saw that love demonstrated again as you have blessed us with just very powerful and dynamic services, and Lord, growth within our services. It's been so exciting to see. As a church family, we've worked hard this year to try to reach more and more people. And God, we're grateful for the harvest that you've brought our way. Tonight, Lord, as we just calm down for just a moment and settle into the important message that you have for us in prayer time, I pray, God, that you'd speak to our hearts. Help us to push aside the craziness of the days and, Lord, even this season that pushes on us from every direction. And God, may we be focused on you. Speak to us through your Holy Spirit tonight, please. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing a little bit more.
Psalm 311, 311, Silent Night, Holy Night, all is calm. We'll sing Silent Night.
We've got a gift card for anyone who wants to come up here and sing that an octave lower, like Brother John did. No, too late. Sir, please be seated if you would. And we had a great time, and thank you for all who participated in the Carols and Cookies on Sunday night, and all the kids who prepared the cookies. They were great. You guys are outdoing yourself every single year, and we had so many submissions this year. It was great, and thank you for that, just having that fun time together. And we're going to have the impromptu men's group come up more often, I think, in our services and just sing some songs for us. And I went easy on them. I was going to do Handel's Messiah, but I decided to do God Rest You Merry Gentlemen instead. And they did a good job with that. I like to just talk about certain things during this time of year that are just kind of important to our heart. I think testimonies and remembering certain maybe special Christmas memories that you have are just an important part of this season, as many of us, we've gathering together with family and hopefully making some good memories in your household during this time of year. But I like to talk about that a little bit. We like to give testimonies about Christmas time here in our service for Candlelight. And so I want you to think about just a couple different things if you'd like to give a testimony tonight. What's your favorite part of Christmas in the spiritual sense? What does it mean specifically to you? I remember, I think it was a couple years ago, preaching to us in Isaiah 9, how it starts out by saying, unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given. How Christmas is a personal holiday for you. It's not a holiday for Western civilization. It's not even just a holiday for Christians or for Americans. It's your holiday. It's God's gift to you. And so what does Christmas mean to you very specifically in your heart? Or perhaps maybe you have a favorite Christmas tradition or memory that you have. A lot of people like to have certain traditions. Maybe it was passed on down to you from your parents or grandparents, whatever it may be. But this is a great time to talk about it. We're not going to have time on it Sunday morning. You got too much to do Christmas Eve. You're going to be running and saying, Pastor, get us out of here on Sunday morning. But tonight we might have a little bit of time for that. So Brother Tin's going to help me out. He's got a microphone quickly. We don't need to take long on this, but just talk about your favorite part of Christmas, what Christmas means to you, or maybe a special memory that you have from times past. Oh, Brother Gio's helping us on this side. So get ready over there as well. Go ahead.
My favorite time is just being with family, not so much as the gifts, but just being together with each other and enjoying each other's company and remembering that it's not all about the gifts. It's just remembering that Christ is the center and the center of the home.
Amen. All right. Anybody over here as we're going from side to, we'll go side to side here. Anybody on this side? Just got a special Christmas memory. Brother Gio's looking. Not, no one over here yet? Well, then start walking backwards, Brother Gio. All right. They don't want to help you out right there. Anyone on this side here? Special Christmas memory or something that Christmas means to you specifically? Brother Sam's got something there.
I just being in the military, you know, time of Christmas, it was always a downtime, so it was always a time that I knew for sure I was going to be home with my family. But there, we have a lot of birthdays, we have anniversaries, we have a lot going on, and Christmas. So I'm always reminded of my family and how God's blessed us and just given us so much, and I'm just grateful for that.
Amen. All right. How about on this side now? Is anyone ready to go? Just gotta put your hand up high enough so you can see it halfway in the dark. Okay. Anyone on this side? No? All right. We're just going to forget about that side now from here on out and stay over here. All right. Miss Irene?
In our family, like Gary and me and Maya, and well, of course, Matt, when they were younger, and we still do it, when we get up in the morning, we do not go open no presents until we open the Bible and read the story of Jesus' birth. And I love it.
Amen.
Doing that first.
All right. A lot of people have that type of thing. As a kid, I always felt that was cruel, but I understand the spiritual reason for it. That's like having all the food on the table at Thanksgiving time set, ready to go, piping hot, and then say, well, let's go around the table and say everything that we're thankful for so we can have a cold turkey to eat. No, I'm just teasing you, Miss Irene. But that is good, keeping that. Some people like to do it. How many of you will read the Christmas story either on Christmas Eve, maybe, perhaps, or that morning, Christmas morning? You like to read it? All right, good, 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 good. All right. Do we have any revival over here? Is there anyone? I see some hands now. Wonderful. Brother John?
Well, as you know, this is my first Christmas since my mom passed away, and my dad died just a year and a half ago, too. So I've been a little nostalgic thinking about them. I remember a Christmas when we were kids, my mom and dad got us a train set and really surprised us with it. My dad, after we went to bed the night before Christmas, he put it all together on a big piece of plywood and got it all set up and everything ready to play with, so that when we got up first thing in the morning, they took us downstairs and it was all set up and ready to go. And I stayed up most of the night, you know, assembling this whole thing. And it was just kind of a special memory. Not only did they get us this train set, which was really cool and we played with for years, but they wanted to surprise us with it, kind of ready to play with right then. I just have a lot of memories of my mom and dad just being neat, neat parents, and just a lot of outstanding things that they were in terms of examples of us and what a great parents should be, you know.
Amen. All right. And that's parents, a lot of work sometimes getting things ready to go the night before on Christmas, that's for sure. So anybody over here on this side? On this side here, Miss Paula has one.
Thank you. Well, something I love about Christmas time is just the way people's hearts are so open and receptive, and they're just so quick. I mean, there's, you know, quick to talk about the Lord and there seems to be just an extra spirit of happiness around for a lot of people. And that's really precious to me, because I remember the day that I realized that I was a Gentile, and I wasn't, I had to be grafted in, and because I thought God was already mine, you know, and that was also a blessing to realize that, you know, like you said, unto us a son is given. And then we had two traditions I was thinking of. One of them was we'd leave the Christmas tree on all night, and just this year, two of my daughters have said that they would get up in the middle of the night when they were little, and they'd wrap a blanket around them, and they'd go and lay under the Christmas tree and look at all the rainbow lights and everything. And then we also lived in the city when they were little, and we'd be wrapping presents like crazy, and then midnight would come, and all the neighbors would step out onto their porch, because there was a guy three houses down that would come out with his bagpipes, and he'd play Amazing Grace. And it was just really wonderful to hear that, just wafting across the air, and all the neighbors standing out at midnight on Christmas Eve listening to that.
Well, amen. That's great. How many bagpipe fans we got in here? Just wondering who I need to pray for. bagpipes, that's a sweet memory. Bagpipes at midnight, though, Miss Paul, I think my reaction would be very different. I'm just kidding. That's unique, though. I mean, it would sound pretty neat in the calm of the night, like that way, that piercing, ear-bleeding sound coming through the quiet of the Christmas Eve night would be very calming. But that was his gift to the neighborhood, though. That's what he had. So it was a unique tradition. Yeah. And there wasn't a BB gun anywhere in sight. Not to be able to put a hole in those things. I'm just teasing you. That wasn't on my street, was it? Okay, good. All right. Just making sure that guy doesn't still live on my name. In the city. That's right. You said in the city. Okay. Anybody over here on this side?
This is the first year that we kind of started the tradition of reading Luke every day of December. And we've been doing it on Zoom with her family. And it's pretty neat to do that and then talk about it with each other afterwards. And the other thing is, I grew up, my mama was a single mom, and we didn't have very much. She sold crafts all year and made quilts, and she saved every dime and change that she had, and we always had a good Christmas. And but she always you know, told us it's about Jesus' birth. And but I just remember, you know, my mom always working real hard all year. I mean, did without a lot just to give us a good Christmas every year.
Amen. All right, anybody else on either side here real quick? All right, then, since we don't have any more, I do know a good way, an easy way to get you to talk. Who's got a favorite meal tradition or Christmas morning snack tradition that you like to have every single... There we go. I knew it was going to happen. Something that you have every year. It's a good tradition, something you like to eat for on Christmas Day.
You know, we're from, Wendy and I are from Oklahoma, so we got to do steak for Christmas. So that's
beef.
Beef.
It's what's for dinner. All right. Some unique food tradition that you have on Christmas. Anybody else? I know you do. Don't even pretend. Maybe you're embarrassed by it. Liverwurst and sauerkraut. Anybody on Christmas? Did you just raise your hand, Brother Gary, back there? Was that in praise or somehow? Amen. All right.
It's scary, isn't it?
What do you got, Brother Gary?
Irene and I usually, Jeremiah requires this homemade Kringles. So we make it each for Christmas morning.
Did you say Kringles or Pringles?
No, it's Kringles, not Pringles.
Okay. What are those? I don't know what that is.
I think we gave you some.
Oh, it's that cake. Okay, I see. I got you. At first, I thought he said Pringles, and I was like, you know, homemade potato chips aren't that bad. I don't know. That's kind of unique for sure. But yeah, no, that's good stuff, though. Yeah, he did let us have one of those not too long ago. And so Kringles, not Pringles. All right. Ms. Lane?
Always thought of a Thanksgiving turkey and a Christmas ham, except this year we're going to do a brisket, so.
Amen. Hallelujah. I can't remember where it's at in the Bible, but I read somewhere where it said, eat what you want on your holidays. Eat what you like. don't let Rockefeller or whatever tell you what you're supposed to eat on your holidays. If you want pizza, eat pizza. If you want whatever, you know. I think we're doing some type of brisket or something like that on Christmas this year, too. I'm not a big turkey fan, so that doesn't work for me. So anybody else, either side, you just got a fun or just a good little thing you like to eat or snack on Christmas Day? Christmas Day, anybody? He's walking back there. Anybody on this side in the meantime? No, I'm looking for ideas. I'm always looking for a good neat.
Okay, thing. So we like ham. Like, ham's our thing. And then the wedding potatoes, you know, they call that with the potato casserole. Not cornflakes on top, but yeah, the potato casserole with lots of cheese.
All right.
Yes.
Hey, ham with like scalloped potatoes or gratin potatoes, that's a good mix right there, something like that. All right, Melissa.
When I was younger, my dad made Chex Mix every year, and as I got older, I kind of learned how to do it from him, so now I make it every year as well, and it's just kind of a fun little thing that we do. I've actually been experimenting with different flavors and stuff, so it's been really fun.
That's good stuff. Homemade stuff is good. Better than homemade Pringles.
True.
That's for sure. And that's a lot of work, too. That's not easy just to whip together really quick. There's a whole science to that, so... Anyways, you do like a sweet and a savory version of it? Yeah, that's how you do it right there. Anybody else, real quick? Just a fun... Alex had one back over here, but we'll come back to you, Alex. Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, everywhere we go, everyone always makes two green bean casseroles, one for everybody else and one for me. So my mama's and my dad's. So
that's how I am about the sweet potato casserole, that stuff. Oh, my goodness. Good stuff. Alex,
so,
No, go ahead. Alex, you're next.
So you wanted unique foods. Growing up, we lived in Germany, and a lot of times we would have Stollen for Christmas, which is like a German raisin bread.
Right. It's like bread pudding with raisins almost. You can soak it too, right?
Yeah, powdered sugar. It was pretty good.
Good times. They had some really neat stuff over there, and we were living in Germany too, and you know, the authentic German Christmas markets and things over there, you can find some really, really nice desserts over there for sure. So, all right.
I started this last year. I started homemaking my eggnog, and so I've been doing that Thanksgiving and Christmas. Yeah.
Wow.
Actually, I did it in July for our Christmas in July. That our Sunday school had as well. So
discovery class, was it good? Does he have a future? And you know, I could see that. You know, with shelled neck. I mean, that's a long. Could put it in really German font on an eggnog carton. There you go, man. Sell that stuff. Put it on there. All right. Anyways, that's good. That's pretty neat. I think I don't know if I've ever heard of anyone homemade, like just down to the very bare with the eggs and the cream and all of that right down. Oh, that's pretty neat. Pretty neat. Okay. Cody, you got one?
So growing up, my family's German-Swedish background, and we had a lot of those types of desserts. And I don't know what the name means, but we would have a dessert called Osterkaka was the name of it. Strange, weird name. Swedish. But it takes to just a small group family get-together. It takes about roughly 8 gallons of milk to make it. You end up cooking the milk and using getting the curd out of the milk and things like that. But it's a huge long process that would take them all day to make, and then it would turn out this extremely sweet, I have never had a dessert like it that was just as good as this was, and put homemade lingonberry preserves on the top or gooseberry preserves and things like that my family would make, and it always fascinated me how much milk it took to make that. But it was my favorite dessert every year. I haven't had it in probably over 10 years, but it's been my favorite.
Sounds good. Lindenberries, and then the name, that's definitely Swedish. That's a Swedish dessert of some kind. So I'm getting this picture of Miss Melissa over there in one side of the kitchen with a giant bowl stirring Chex Mix like crazy. And Cody on the other side of the kitchen with a giant tub just pouring, double fisting, pouring gallons of milk while he's stirring it. That, what a Christmas you guys have out there. I'm telling you what. Oh my goodness. Anyway, maybe one more if we have one. One more. Anybody else have one? No? Okay, that's all right. That's all right. I just enjoy sharing this, like our family Christmas together, talking about those things. We do different things every year. We always have hot chocolate that morning while we're opening presents. And my parents, my mom used to make blueberry pancakes every morning, and I would remember those on Christmas. But we would always eat whatever's in the stocking was free game that morning until real food arrived. So if we had any candy or anything like that, any treats in the stocking, that was usually the first thing you ended up eating that morning. I know it was great for you, but we enjoyed it. And cinnamon rolls sometimes on Sunday. Anybody do cinnamon rolls on Sunday morning, on Christmas morning? That's a good thing to do too. But I hope you have a good time. It's on Monday this year. Let me remind you, Christmas Eve service is just in the morning. And so we will have Sunday school. We'll have our Bible classes at 9:45, 10:45 for the main service, and that'll be a great time. Lots of extra music and singing. It'll be a great service. You'll enjoy it very, very, very much. And that's a formal service for us. I want us to really be focused on church before Christmas that day, okay? So make sure you're prepared for that. And then I know that there's rain coming and going or whatever perhaps around that, but assuming the weather doesn't get too hairy, we are planning on Saturday morning going out and trying to invite people to that Christmas Eve service. So if you're able to be here at 10 o'clock, we'll knock on some doors and invite people and hopefully have a great time doing that. So let's pray for good weather on that day. I don't want to miss too many of these weeks inviting folks to come to our services. And so just consider that very, very much. Is there anything else for Larry that's hovering over us a little bit? But morning of Christmas Eve and New Year's Eve, there's going to be Sunday school and the main service. There'll be no evening services both of those Sundays. Don't forget about Vision Sunday as well, coming up the following week, and our annual workers meeting. If you are a worker in any of our ministries here, we do expect you to be there for that. And it'll be a great time together. We'll have a meal together in the morning and then go over some training materials and just some helps and encouragements to you. And we don't have a ton of turnover in our workers, so we're going to try to keep it light and get you out a little earlier than we have over the last couple of years. So keep those things in mind. Did anyone not get a prayer list tonight? We're going to do a prayer time just a little different tonight, but if you need one, get your hand up real high so they can see you, please, if you would. I want to point out a couple of important things on here, and then we're all going to pray together as a church group. I don't know if I want everyone shifted around in the auditorium during this service, but a couple of things to remind you about. Little Nora has been sick now for how many? Almost a week coming up now, I think. Yeah. She's had a very high fever, and it's down a little bit today. I heard a little bit. Still high, though. Still high fever. Yeah, so very high fever and some leg pain, very severe leg pain, and they're trying to figure out what's going on right now. And so be in prayer for their family, please, if you would, and that the doctors will find, if there's something there, we need them to find it, figure out what it is, and be able to help her, okay? So be in prayer for little Nora, please, if you would, and be in prayer for the vehicles of everyone in our church, if you would, just every single person. We just need to pray for our cars, lift them up in prayer. We might have a national day of fasting for our vehicles at some point along the way. McAllister's got some things going on, a few others in our church as well. And so that's a big stressor on your life when you got something going on with your vehicle. So think about those and be in prayer for those. And then would you be a couple other things as well to be in prayer for? Be in prayer for Miss Donna as well, Miss Donna Perry. And she's got had to go to the doctors, wasn't feeling super great, and her blood pressure was very high, strangely high. And so they're trying to get that under control for her. And just be in prayer for her, please, if you would. And then also, Connor, remind me, please, where it's your... Yes, his girlfriend's grandmother had a stroke and not doing well at all. They're going to put her in hospice care, right? And so be in prayer for his girlfriend, Haley, her grandmother, and be in prayer for that situation, please, if you would. If there's anything else pressing that I need to know about that the church can pray for tonight, would you just let me know real quickly and just slip your hand up nice and high so I can see you, please. Gio?
Hi, Mom.
Okay. Would you pray for Cheryl, please, if you would? Oh, your biological mom. Okay. So pray for his biological mom. Pray for her with Crohn's and surgery that's coming up that way. Okay. Anybody else? Who's okay? I can't. You're right in the shadow, and I'm so sorry. I felt so bad. Good, Brother DeClue. I see you now. Okay. All right. And that's been ongoing for a little while, and we just want Landon to be in the best position possible, and we certainly want him here in our church, and so be in prayer for that as they fight that battle there a little bit, if you would. Okay. Anybody else that I'm missing along the way? Okay. Here's what I'd like for us to do. Let's be in prayer for our services, of course, on Christmas Eve, that we'd have some more guests, and God would continue to fill this place up as he's done. So I want to remind you about, we had someone from the county was out here today and taking a look at our buildings for getting in preparation for our final inspection. We're just about ready. Unfortunately, during the time of our carpet getting installed, a door to our offices was left open, and the wind caught it and broke one of the windows in our new building. And so we can't get our final inspection done until that window is fixed. But from what I was told today, it looks like we're really close. Maybe once we get that fixed, hopefully in the next couple of weeks. It's already been ordered and things like that. But we're very, very, very close to final inspections on this now, and I got some more guidance today on that. So be in prayer for the building project, trying to get in there at the beginning of the year. That's what we've been wanting to do, and so we're close. We're very, very, very close. So thank you and all your prayer for that. Okay, if we could, I'd like both of our deacons, Brother Patrick in the back, you don't need the microphone to do this. Would you start us off in prayer? Just stand up where you are and just take whatever you'd like. Pray for the front end of our list, please, if you could. Just for our church, for our services coming up, and that God would help us and bless us here in this area. And then Brother Sam, if you want to pick some of the needs that are on that list as well and pray. And then Brother Tinnan's going to come up after him and close us. You can pick whatever you would like alongside that as well. And just close us out in prayer. Let's pray alongside them. We're not just listening to their prayer, and we're reinforcing their prayer with our own prayers, okay? And so we're not going to have any piano. I want to be able to hear the men praying, but it's a little different tonight, but that's okay. But let's join one another in prayer. Our church is always going to be our greatest need. Prayer will be the greatest need that we have to allow the Lord to work through our ministry. And so we want to take this time very seriously, okay? Brother Patrick, you go ahead.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we do thank you for this evening. We thank you for this time of year that we have, that we get a, I know it's a national holiday that our country has set aside, Lord, that we recognize the birth of our Savior, and I understand and that there are countries and people around the world, they don't celebrate Christmas, but Lord, whether you celebrate it or whether you're not, the fact still remains that just over 2,000 years ago, you sent your Son to be born of a virgin so that he could live a perfect life, die and pay for our sins so that we could have a home in heaven. Lord, he rose and he's sitting in heaven next to you right now, oh God, and we thank you for it. That's just a fact that will never be changed because you are the Savior of the world. Our missionaries, we have missionaries across this land, across this world trying to reach the lost with the gospel. They're trying to just give the good news of your Son to a lost and dying world, Lord. I think of our country. They need Jesus Christ. They need you. They need to come to know you as their Savior. I think of Jefferson County. The best thing that our county could get from our church, Lord, is if we would just preach Christ, if we would just give your Son to everyone that we see through the gospel. I even think of kids on my bus route. They know who Jesus Christ is as far as Lord, he was born, and they think that he was just given special abilities, but they don't understand that he is God, that the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost are all one God. Lord, they don't get that. And I just ask that you'd help our church. That's why we're here. I know we like to have fun events, and we try and do things and have fellowship together, which we need as a church. But Lord, just like our missionaries, our goal here in Jefferson County is to give the gospel to the lost and dying, to meet the needs of the people that you have given us in our area to reach. And I just ask that you be with our church, be with pastor as he leads us. Lord, he gets up and he preaches your word each and every Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday, any other services. We go out visitation. Lord, there's all kinds of things we do with the gospel. We just ask that you would continue to guide him as he guides our church. And Lord, I ask that you'd be with our church, that we would just get behind him wholeheartedly, and that we would just go out and give the gospel. Lord, tell them about your son, Jesus Christ, because I testimony of most everyone in here, they're saved, they know you as Savior. And Lord, what a shame it would be to not go out and give that gift to someone else. I know we're all excited about Christmas, but Lord, the best gift we can give, again, is Jesus Christ and the news that he came to pay for our sin. Lord, so just bless our church as we go out, as we finish this year, that we'd finish it strong. And let 2024, let it be a year of growth, not just numerically for our church, but Lord, spiritually, that our church would grow and would see needs of the people in our church and the needs of the people in our community reached, as we reach them with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We ask that you bless our services tonight. Just let it be special. Let us leave here knowing that we heard Christ. We pray. Amen.
Let's all stand one more time. Stand together with me. Grab the hymn book right there, Psalm 305, 305, O Little Town of Bethlehem. Let's all stand together. O Little Town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie.
Offering quickly, ushers, if you can come forward, and thank you for all the support you've given us throughout this year. Thank you for the many who've participated in our Christmas gift to our church and allowing us to take care of some of these final needs for our building program. But just give as God has laid upon your heart. That's all I ask you to do here tonight. Father, thank you for our church. Thank you for a time we can gather together and, Lord, feel like a family and feel like we're united in the same purpose and vision for our church. And, Lord, I do greatly enjoy the fellowship and the fact that we're here, Lord, the sweet spirit we have in our church. And Lord, many folks here have chosen to invest of their life into our ministry. And Lord, you have worked through us. You've done a great work through us, especially this year. And thank you for meeting our needs financially. Thank you for doing that not only in our own homes, but for our church as well. I pray, Lord, that you'd help us to use the resources we have for your glory, to help others, to reach others, God. And I pray that you would cause us to be faithful, Lord, in this area of our life as we give to our church. And I pray that you'd bless the rest of our service, Lord. Help us in the sermon time to follow, please. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Be seated. Thank you, Brother Caleb, for that. Luke chapter number 2. Luke chapter number 2, if you're able to see what you're reading. And this was the vision test for all of us this year to know if we need to go to the doctor. I'm thinking next year I may have like a headlamp or something that I'll just put on one of those things and I can look down and see what I'm doing. But Luke chapter number 2, and we're going to look towards the end of the chapter. And verse number 25 is where we're going to be at tonight. And I want to talk about Simeon here in the Christmas story. Simeon, as we look at another light of Christmas, this is our candle light service. And so I think it's fitting for us to have a theme on that in the message tonight. Verse number 25, Luke chapter number 2. And behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And the same man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel. And the Holy Ghost was upon him. And it was revealed unto him by the Holy Ghost that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him after the custom of the law, then took he him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace, according to thy word. For mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel. And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. I'd like to talk a little bit about that man Simeon tonight and how he saw the light of the world that day. To the world shrouded in darkness of unattainable commandments. The Jewish people back in that particular time were left with a law that was not just what God gave them, but what man decided to add unto it. Multiple volumes of books that contained the law, the Torah, that the people had to try and live by. Many of those were unattainable, almost impossible to live by, kind of like if we were just trying to read our entire U.S. code that we have today of laws. It's just so bloated and overcome with things, it'd be almost impossible. You probably would read it and realize you're probably a 3 or 4 time felon, don't even know about it yet, I don't know. They also had unexplained rituals. They had things that they had to go about that many people by this particular time in history probably didn't even understand why the Sabbath existed. And they knew that it was important. They knew that they would be forced to do it if the religious leaders caught them acting against the Sabbath, but it was unexplained. Many of the things that they did as a Jewish people were very unexplained to them. They didn't know why they were even doing what they were doing. And what they would consider to be unfulfilled prophecies. Every Jewish person was growing up with the hope that one day the Messiah would come and deliver them from the darkness that they were living in at that particular time. But God sent his Son to give light to all those who walked in darkness. It was a time of great darkness when Jesus was born, as is the time which we are living in today. I think of verses both brought up in the book of John and also in the book of 1 John that talk about the light of who Jesus was. In John chapter 1, the very beginning of the chapter, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him there was not anything made that was made. To him was life, and this life was the light of men. What Jesus came to offer was a light in the darkness. And verse number 5, and the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. We are the darkness. We were living in darkness. We were born of darkness in our sin. And the light came to us, and we could agree probably in this room as we look forward that when God first began entering into our lives, the thought of God, the promises of God, the Word of God, many of us, when the light was given to us, we comprehended it not. What in the world is this all about? Just as I think about how Mary kept all those things and pondered them in her heart. And we see here Mary and Joseph once again at the end of their time there at the temple after dedicating Jesus to the Lord, as was common and a place for Jewish children to be dedicated in that way. They marveled at the things that were told about Jesus. And the light came into the darkness and we comprehended it not. What is this all about? And we talk about, it goes on in John chapter 1 with John the Baptist. He was there to be a witness, to bear witness of the light in verse number 7, that all men through him might believe. The Bible tells us very clearly that the problem in this world is not so much that the darkness exists. Sin will be present here on this earth until God permanently does away with it. God's concern is not so much the fact that there's sin here in this world, because it is what it is now. It will not change until eternity future. But the Bible has told us over and over and over again that the situation is the way it is because men are living in darkness without anyone showing them the light. And if the light was there for them, and if the light showed up in their life and began revealing things to them, he said that they would believe. We read that there in verse number 7. The same came for a witness, that was John the Baptist, to bear witness of the light, capital L, by the way, that all men through him might believe. God is telling us that the mandate for us, the importance for us, yes, this Christmas time and even beyond, is we are living in dark times as they lived in dark times in Luke chapter number 2. But if we would only bring the light into people's view, the light would give perspective to people. The light would show people things that they're not seeing on their own. And there will be people who believe because of it. Verse number 8, he was not that light, talking about John the Baptist, but was sent to bear witness of that light. Oh, I would agree with you probably that none of us are John the Baptist. In fact, Jesus told us himself that there wasn't any greater born among women than John the Baptist. But we do still have the same message that John the Baptist had. We have the same person to point to that John the Baptist had. If we would only give folks a little taste of what light could be like in their life as they live in darkness every single day. I think of the book of 1 John chapter 1 and verse number 5 also. This then is the messenger which we have heard of him and declare unto you that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. Christmas time, as we've heard multiple people talk about it, and Brother Tinnen talked about it some in his prayer tonight, the need of our area, Jefferson County, is not even necessarily that we have a massive church for them to go to. That might be the end result of their need, but that's not the greatest need here tonight. The need of our area is that they could see the light. And I think it's very sad for us to consider that, well, if they want the light, they'll get it. Well, let's look at your life for a second, shall we? I would believe that the overwhelming majority of people here in this room tonight have that light in your life. You're no longer dwelling in the darkness and the sin and the wickedness of this world, but you have a light in your life because someone, whether they were physically at your door, in your life, lived in your home, maybe even on a TV screen or whatever it may be, there was a someone. There was a John the Baptist in your life who testified of that light. And because of the power of that light, and because of the very presence of that light, and the fact that the light illuminated some things for you, you believed. The light of Christmas is so very important, as we have heard over and over how people talk more about the Lord during this time of year. They talk about His birth. They talk about God's gift to us. There's little flickers all over around this world right now of light. Amen. I just wish there'd be some Christians who would step out of the shadows for a minute and turn on their high beams and show people that great light that has been in our own life. I'd like to point out a couple things from the story here from Simeon to help us when we look at the light of Christmas and how important it needs to be people showing a light out there in the darkness. What should we do as Christians today? What should Bethel Baptist Church do while we're trying to serve in the midst of darkness? It's really not much different from Luke chapter 2 in the day and age that we're living in right now. A lot of spiritual darkness, a lot of misunderstandings regarding how to serve the Lord, how to find the Lord, what is the Lord's purpose even in someone's life. It was very much the same during this time of the year. So church, how do we serve in a dark time? Well, Simeon gave us a great example here. If you look in the scriptures, I find number one, that we ought to be doing good when others are going about their way as they want to go. We ought to be the ones doing good. If you saw in verse number 27 of what we were reading about who Simeon was, and the type of man that he was. Look at verse number 25. First of all, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. The same man was just and devout. Well, Pastor, that makes sense. He worked in the temple. Now, hold on a second. Hold on. Have we not read of others who were priests and worked in temples who were far from just and devout? There was no guarantee, because his physical presence was at the temple and he served there, that he was going to be a just man. He made that decision on his own to be not only just and devout, but I like how it said he was waiting for the consolation of Israel. The consolation is referring to the redemption that was going to take place. Everyone else was going about their day. Well, we're under Roman rule now. It's just another line of succession. At first it was the Babylonians, and then it became the Persians, and then it was the Assyrians after that, and now it's the Romans. All right, just a new ruler. People are going about their daily lives. No one's looking for the consolation of Israel. In fact, we know they weren't looking because everybody missed it. But there was a man, Simeon, who was living his life justly and devoutly in the midst of great spiritual darkness, and he also had his eyes pointed on what he knew was going to be the solution for his people. He was doing right. He was being who he was supposed to be, even though the rest of the world was going through the motions. We have been warned by our Savior that in the last days it will be much the same way. People will be going about their life as if nothing's wrong, as if everything is the way it is, even though there's spiritual darkness everywhere. Folks, we need to be like Simeon, living justly, living devoutly, and looking for the salvation of the Lord to come. Secondly, serving here in these dark times means that we ought to be following in the leading of the Lord. Following in the leading of the Lord. Would you look with me at verse number 25 first? We see, yes, that he was a just man. He was devout. He was waiting for the consolation of the Lord. I like this at the very end of 25. And the Holy Ghost was upon him. The Holy Ghost was upon him. And you know, we know that the Holy Ghost was upon him, not because he was gifted the Holy Ghost, not because he just happened to be the right man at the right time, or because he was a priest. He had the Holy Ghost. I think that the Holy Ghost was upon him for this very reason. If you look in verse number 27, and he came by the Spirit into the temple. This tells me a couple very important things. Why was the Holy Ghost upon him? Church, I want the Holy Spirit's presence in my life. We want his presence in our services. We pray for that often around here. Holy Spirit, please guide our services. Please direct. Please help me as I preach. Help our people to get something from your word. And that's great. I think we should ask and seek and try to yield ourselves to the Holy Spirit in that way. We want the Holy Spirit's influence and power and presence on our life. However, it doesn't just come by osmosis. It doesn't just come because we're in a building. It doesn't even just come because the Word of God is open. I've been in many services, and I've sat in many services where the Word of God was read, and the Word of God was preached, and the Word of God was open, and I did not feel much of the Holy Spirit's presence in that service, whether it was an issue with the servants itself or an issue in my own heart. They were at the temple. Well, the Holy Ghost should be there, right? No, I see the example of why the Holy Ghost was upon Simeon, because he followed the Holy Ghost. He followed the Holy Ghost, and he came by the Spirit into the temple. So by the Spirit means he was what? We could use a word that starts with L and ends in ed. He was what? Oh, come on now. Start with L and ends in ed. It means he was what? Led. Thank you. I know it's dark, but you can still speak. It's all right. He was led by the Spirit. Was he forced by the Spirit? Did the Holy Spirit pick him up and move him into the temple? No, he didn't float in. He felt an impression from the Holy Ghost. You need to be in the temple right now. He wasn't the only priest there. He wasn't the only one serving in the temple. There were many. It was a big production. But somehow, some way, the Holy Ghost impressed upon the heart of Simeon, you need to be in there now. It almost makes me think that it might not even have been completely his time. Now, we don't know that for sure. They had schedules and things to work. But the Holy Ghost had told him, you should probably be in the temple right now, and he obeyed. He was where the Holy Ghost told him to go. He listened to the voice of the Holy Ghost in his life. How was the Holy Ghost upon him, Pastor? Why did he get that gift? I just think it's because he said yes. Oh, Pastor, I wish we could be like Simeon and be led that way and have great things happen to us and see God's work. Simeon was given a great gift to witness the Messiah. Wouldn't have happened if he wouldn't have followed the Holy Ghost leading in his life. Church, if we look at the Christmas season now, and as we go forward in our church into 2024, I don't understand why we should even bother praying for the Holy Spirit to guide our services. I don't even understand why we should even consider using the Holy Spirit in our services or seeking Him if we will not obey what He tells us to do. How can we say that we're a church that's filled with the Holy Spirit? How can we say that the Holy Spirit's presence is really truly in our services if we are constantly rejecting Him and quenching Him when He's speaking to us? How can we serve in the midst of darkness like Simeon did? We need to be the type of people that Simeon was. We need to be just and devout, yes, but we need to be following the leading of the Lord in our life. Where God tells us to go, we go. What God tells us to do, we do. What God tells us to give up, we give up. I also see that we should be having a constant attitude of gratefulness. A constant attitude of gratefulness. I look at verse number 28 there. Then he took him up in his arms and he blessed God. He blessed God there. And he said, Lord, now let thy servant depart in peace according to thy word, for mine eyes have seen that salvation. He begins praising the Lord. How can we get through this time of darkness? It may be like this, church. I'm not trying to be doom and gloom for you tonight, but the darkness that we're in tonight as a nation and as a worldview and as we are in Christendom itself, how do you really think it's just all going to turn around? One day we're going to wake up and everything's going to be great. The devil is getting more and more and more and more bold, and Christians are retreating more and more and more and more and more. How are we going to survive? How are we going to do what we need to do in the times of darkness? We need to have a constant attitude of gratefulness. Amen. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. We have to be grateful for what God is doing. That's why I think right now more than anything, we need to be bombarding the Lord with gratefulness for what he's been doing in our church as of late. Amen. Don't look out there. There's much to be despondent about. There's much to be depressed about. A lot. Maybe some of that is within your own home, and you've got to set that aside for a moment. And when God brings his work into your life, as God brought the work of the Messiah into the life of Simeon, what he had been hoping for, he thanked the Lord and he blessed the Lord for it. An attitude of gratefulness will get us a long way in times of darkness. I've got that little sign in my office. I think it's still there unless it's been knocked over or broken since then. I can't remember, but it says, attitude is a little thing that makes a big difference. Attitude is a little thing that makes a big difference. We must have an attitude of gratefulness as a church. I don't know about you, but I like to do things for people when I feel like they appreciate what I'm doing. And when you do something special over the top for somebody, you don't hear anything about it, not a thank you, not a card, not a whisper, not a praise, nothing. How likely are you to get excited about doing that again next time? We need to have an attitude of gratefulness, church, as Simeon did. And then what happens when the light actually comes into your life, as it did that day for Simeon? Would you look with me in verse number 29? Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace, according to thy word. Your life has sudden meaning and peace when the light comes into it. Let me remind you of this tonight about the meaning that God gave to your life when he chose to make you his child. Amen. When he saved you from your sins and put his presence inside of you and quickened you and made you alive, as the Bible tells us. Amen. He brought a lot of purpose, a lot of meaning and peace in your life about life's greatest mystery. What happens to us when we die? Simeon was a man serving for many years. We don't know how old he was. Tradition tells us he was 113 years old. There's nothing in Scripture that says he was actually that old. We get clues that he might have been nearing the end. You're not going to die. In other words, you should be dying, but you're not because you haven't seen the Messiah yet. But he met the Savior that day. He had that light come into his life, and he said, you know what? Now I can go on in peace. Think about that for us today. Think about that moment that Jesus Christ entered into your life and how your life took a whole new direction. Amen. I don't know about you. I get so burdened for those that I see walking aimlessly around our life and just going through the motions. It's Christmas. They're trying to be happy, but many of them are not. And I just wonder, what would their life look like if Jesus was in it? What would their life look like if they met him at the temple of their heart like Simeon met him that day? And there was some light finally showing in some dark places of their life. You think their life might look a little different? Well, if experience teaches us anything, it made our life look different, and I think it'll make their life look different too. When the light comes into your life has hope in the Lord's salvation. I like what he says there in verse number 30. For mine eyes have seen thy salvation. When the light comes into your life has hope because of the Lord's salvation. As we minister and we serve here in these dark times, we must not forget that He came to seek and to save that which was lost. And people are lost all around us, not just in direction in their life, but their sin has dominated them from the moment that they were born. They need the light. They need that hope that we have here today. Why can we smile? Why can we be excited? Why can we look at the news or look at what's going on and say, you know what, it's all going to be okay? Because there's hope found in you. You didn't generate that hope. You didn't create it inside of you. The light of the world came in and gave you that hope. I think about how when the light of the world comes into your life is immediately improved from its previous state. It's instant plus, instant improvement, just like how Simeon tells us here in verse number 32 when he says, a light to lighten the Gentiles, to illuminate them, to let them know that there's hope and there's truth for them. They all thought salvation was only of the Jews. When Jesus came, he's going to change that mindset very quickly. He says, they're going to be illuminated. The Gentiles, their position, going to be improved. What did he say there about the Jews as well? And the glory of thy people Israel. Both groups, Jews and Gentiles, were going to be improved because the light of the world came. Can we not testify tonight that our life is better? Amen. It's better. We toy around with sin so much, church. I could say to you, if you really think sin is that good, why don't you just go headfirst into it? Enjoy it. Love it. I wouldn't want to do that, Pastor. Why? It's destructive, isn't it? Don't forget from whence you came. Before the light was there, He has improved every aspect. Hope improved. Purpose improved. Joy improved. Eternity much improved. And then you see how your life is opened up to the wonders of God. When the light comes into your life, you begin a relationship with God that you didn't have before, and you start to see Him manifest His works and His wonders in your life. As I see in verse number 33, when He said, when Joseph and Mary and his mother marveled at these things which were spoken of Him. I hope that it's during not only this Christmas time, but also as we move into next year, we'll spend a lot of time marveling at the works of the Lord. Amen. I hope you'll find a song in your heart like, God is so good. He's so good to me. He answers prayer. He forgives sin. He loves me so. Pick whatever verse you want to pick. But spending some time marveling at the wonders of God in your life. Joseph and Mary, it's amazing. You would think that nothing would wow them at this point. I mean, they've kind of been through a miraculous birth, right? But yet they saw God has even more in store for us. Don't let all the wonder be at your moment of salvation. I'm glad for that wonder. I'm glad that we wonder at the time when Jesus first entered into our life. But let me remind you, just as Joseph and Mary were at the temple that day, God has more wonders for you to marvel at in store for you. Amen. They didn't have to spend the rest of their lives just thinking, well, remember, no matter how bad it gets, just remember, we still at least have Bethlehem. No, God wanted to do a lot more work in their life. And God wants to do a lot of work in your life as well today. Live beyond the salvation moment and let God do some great things in your life going forward. Because of Christmas, because of the light that God brought into this world, I think of these things. Those that were lost in darkness of sin can behold the light of the gospel. Because of Christmas, the prodigal who has wandered from home can see the light of forgiveness and welcome. And because of Christmas, those who faced with questions and decisions can walk in the light of that wonderful counselor that we talked about. And because of Christmas, all those burdened with sorrow and heartache can find the light of hope in their life. Two things tonight for us as we finish. Are you still wondering Are you still marveling like Joseph and Mary did about what God is trying to do in your life? I find that that point on serving in darkness and having an attitude of forgiveness has been key for me in getting through what is the ups and downs of life. Still marveling at what God's trying to do in your life today. Has the marvel all ran out? Has the wonder all ran out? Oh, we need a little pick-me-up every Easter and Christmas. That's twice a year. What about the other 363 days? Where's the wonder of God? It ought not to be a tremendous choir special or the most dynamic message that comes from the pulpit that should cause you to be in awe of the Lord. The light is right there dwelling inside of you, ready to show you the wonders of God. Then I think it's pretty obvious for us. Are we sharing the light? Are we sharing the light? I don't think that Simeon and Anna kept this to themselves. I don't think they just went back today, oh, well, we saw the Messiah. That was great. What's next on the agenda for today? It changed them. When the Lord enters into our life, it changes us and causes us to want to go and tell. We can't sing, "Go Tell It on the Mountain," that Jesus Christ was born, if we're not willing to do it ourselves. God has wonder not just for us, but he has wonder for all out there as well. We've got a few days left. Saturday morning at 10 o'clock, we'll go try to tell people about the wonder that God has for them. Are you still marveling at his goodness? Are you telling others about that goodness that God has in store? The light of Christmas still shining today. It's really dark, Pastor. I don't know. Is it going to make a difference? Well, in the darkest rooms, the light makes the difference. Let's go punch some holes in the darkness through the rest of this week, shall we? Would you stand with me? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this time together. Lord, I know not a really dynamic message necessarily. Didn't intend on that tonight, but Lord, we are serving in some dark times as Simeon served. But Lord, I think every single day, Simeon had to wait his entire life, Lord, for you to show your presence to him. God, I'm so grateful that you're available to us every hour of every day now. We can find you whenever we seek you. You're available, Lord, to show us your goodness. I pray as a church that we would be grateful. And Lord, that we would use that gratefulness and put it to action, telling others about you. I pray you'd inspire our church, please, to shine some light out there in the darkness. Thank you for your gift to us. Thank you for loving us. I pray you'd help us, Lord, to be challenged in our hearts. Thank you for those who are here tonight. Give us safety, Lord, as we travel home. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much for being here tonight. I hope that you'll find someone to give the light to in the next few days. Let them see who God is in your life and what he can do for them. I hope that one day when we get to heaven, that great white throne judgment, we won't have to see the plans that God had for every single one of those people. What they could have been. We're talking about regret. We're talking about tears. Regret brings a lot of sorrow about what could have been. I promise you this week, you will pass somebody who God has a plan for their life. Amen. And it might just be fulfilled if they saw the light. John the Baptist preached that they would see the light and believe. Let's consider that for us in the next few days as well. We're going to turn the lights up a little bit in just a moment as we fellowship around. We've got practices, right, tonight, I think. So don't forget about that. I think Brother Anthony needs to meet with a group to practice, so don't forget about that as well. But I hope to see you on Saturday morning. And if not, I will see you Sunday morning for those services. Hey, you don't have a Sunday night service, so maybe you can come to Sunday school, too. 9:45. Then you won't be overloaded with too much church that day. Just think about that. I love you. Thank you for your prayers. Let's pray for all these sick folks, please, and to think of them if you would. But I hope to see you back by the end of this week. Have a great night.